If you primarily know of Quentin Tarantino's new film Inglourious Basterds from its posters and trailers, you're likely under the assumption that it's basically another Kill Bill-style genre riff, only this time as a revenge flick set in World War II framed around a team of Jewish soldiers tasked with slaughtering the Nazis in occupied France. For good or ill, this marketing-fueled idea of what the film is has probably helped make up your mind about whether or not you should go see it, and I'm here to tell you, you might want to rethink that. Because the movie teased in those trailers is not entirely the one now playing in theaters. Oh, the Basterds are certainly there, and they're certainly awesome, the kind of arch-exploitation movie characters reconfigured into three-dimensional humans that Tarantino specializes in. And they do indeed slice, dice, and bludgeon Nazis into gooey little bits before scalping them. But they're only one part of a sprawling cloak-and-dagger spy fantasy that also interweaves the stories of a British film critic-turned-soldier, a double-agent German movie star, a naive Nazi war hero, a vengeance-seeking Jewish refugee, and even Der Führer himself. Everyone has their own separate narrative tracks, but they're all ultimately going to the same place. A gala premiere for a Nazi propaganda film, where events conspire that could change the course of the war and history itself. You may have noticed that for a war movie, a curiously large number of the characters and story points revolve around movies and filmmaking. Well, look who we're talking about. In fact, let us pause to consider Quentin Tarantino. He burst onto the scene in the early 90s with scary good writing and filmmaking chops in one hand and a foundational base of obscure cinema cross-reference in the other. Many of the old guard film critics, impressed by the first hand, welcomed and lauded him for his sharp scripting and complex direction, largely assuming that the film geek genre love that peppered his work was something he'd leave behind as he grew up. That, of course, isn't what happened, and thank God. Much to the chagrin of some in that old guard, Tarantino quickly revealed that neither his apparent preference for cinematic artifice over realism, nor his foundational affection for the geek side of cinema history were passing fancies, but rather akin to the very core of his artistic soul. In fact, if one lays the man's work as director, writer, and even actor out side by side, a clear pattern begins to emerge. The fusion of low movie genres like sleazy crime sagas, horror, and even kung fu with well-developed characterization, clever story structure, and labyrinthine conversational dialogue. That dialogue takes center stage once again here. Aside from a few sporadic scenes of violence, this is primarily a spy thriller built around a series of conversation sequences wherein various interlopers try to talk their way into and out of trouble, resulting in some punishingly suspenseful moments where dozens of characters are all telling five or six lies at once, with their very lies resting on how well they can pull it off. In any case, at first glance, Basterds is certainly following Tarantino's by now well-known stylistic flourishes. Violence? Check. Pop culture references? Check. Chapter headings? Check. Movie fixation? Check. Except this time, there's a different sort of edge. The violence happens in isolated scenes and quick bursts. Most of the film is pretty subtle. The pop culture references remain fixed on the era-appropriate culture of the 1940s. The chapter headings are just chapter headings, okay, but the movie fixation is what now carries the biggest added weight. In many ways, Tarantino's films have always been about cinema itself, the invasion and conquest of reality by movie fantasy. But here, that subtext finally spills over onto the main text, as Inglourious Basterds reveals itself as a fanciful meditation on the concept of film as a weapon. Not only in the way that so much of its plot focuses on the career, philosophy, and villainous aims of Nazi propaganda master Joseph Goebbels, but also in its construction of an alternative history wherein the Third Reich can be brought to its knees by the kind of exaggerated heroes that only come from movies, and, ultimately, even by the movies themselves. See it, you'll understand what I mean. Of course, the release of each new Tarantino movie brings with it the tiresome question of where it stands in the context of his other films, but, frankly, I'm sick of it. Everything a director makes doesn't have to be either his best ever or the beginning of the end. As far as I'm concerned, I doubt he'll ever make something quite as perfect and visionary as the Kill Bill cycle again anytime soon, but then again, neither will anyone else, so whatever. What matters here is that Inglourious Basterds is a very, very good movie that infuses fresh new life into the World War II genre and adds another title to the emergingly prominent subgenre of ass-kicking Jew revenge flicks. With a fun comic turn by Brad Pitt and a shockingly good turn by Eli Roth as, well, you'll see. But more substantively, what could be star-making performances by Melanie Laurent as pretty much the real hero of the story and Christoph Waltz as the brutal Nazi supervillain codenamed the Jew Hunter. It's definitely another strange mix of B-movie thrills and verbose sophistication from Tarantino, but damned if it doesn't still work, and I definitely recommend you check it out. See you next time.
Yes, 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 yes.